I'm Shiraz, Maher. I'm Deputy Director of ICSR, and on behalf of ICSR and King's College London, I'd like to thank you all for coming here, and indeed to Trends Advisory and Research for the excellent partnership we've been building with you guys over the last few years. In particular, I want to thank Dr. Ahmed and Dr. Richard for the support and the collaboration that we've been building with you guys. It's an honor for us to be working with you guys in this regard. This conference couldn't be more timely, really, since we even began just planning it. There's been a whole range of terrorist attacks, particularly, of course, in France and in Germany, as you will have all have seen. And I think it really speaks to just how important an issue this is, that as we've been putting together the list of people just attending, we've had people flying in from other parts of Europe to come and hear what will be discussed here over the next 2 days. So I think this is an important moment to be having this conversation. And I'm delighted that we have the list of speakers that we do, and I thank you all for coming in and giving up your time to be part of this. Just two other very small housekeeping rules. There are some politicians here, so I just reiterate, everything is on the record in this room, so it's worth remembering that, because we've had incidents in the past that didn't go brilliantly. And finally, if you are tweeting about this event, then please use the hashtag that you can see up there, ISIS in Europe. And with that, that's all I wanted to say by way of introductory remarks. And so, Richard, over to you.
Great. Thanks, Shiraz. Thanks, everybody, for coming. I'm Dr. Richard Birchall, Director of Research and Engagement at Trends Research and Advisory. On behalf of Dr. Ahmed and Trends, I wish to thank ICSR, your entire staff, Katie, who has snuck out, as she always does, and the thank yous come out. Really good to work with you. We're glad to see so many people here. And as Shiraz made clear, this event could not come at a better or worse time, depending how you look at it. Typically, when you introduce events, you always look for something to tie it in with current events. Unfortunately, we've had too many instances. Looking forward to the next day and a half, the insights we have from our experts, from our speakers, and from yourselves. The panels are all set up in such a way the speakers will give 10 to 15 minutes, and then we're looking for a very good, a very engaging Q&A as well. So we want to hear from you guys as well as from our experts. Just to reiterate, everything is on the record. It is all being filmed. It is being videoed. So just want to make sure we get that officially in. Right, for our first session today, we have Shiraz, we have Alberto, and we have Nancy. Their bios are all in your conference pack, so I'm not going to go through their bios, except we all know they're all very well-recognized experts. And so without any further ado, Alberto, I'd like to turn proceedings over to you.
Thank you very much, Richard. It's a pleasure to be with you all. I'm really honored to be here, and certainly with a lot of really great scholars and experts that I admire, including Nancy and Shiraz, whose work I am a deep admirer of. You know, when we look at the Islamic State in Europe, or we look at the Islamic State worldwide, it seems that still too much of our energy when we talk about it, when we focus about it, is misaligned. We see wasted effort in either exaggerating the threat, the Muslims are coming, these are quotation marks, or dismissing it. This has nothing to do with Islam, you know, these are not the droids you are looking for, it's some other thing. Rather than looking at it seriously, coldly, with all its dangers and also with all its limitations. ISIS today is an extreme part of an amorphous, complex, competing wave of Islamist activism and violence, a would-be global insurgency drawing its venom from the catastrophes of the Middle East, of the Sunni Arab Muslim world, and a modern revolutionary ideology built upon the bones of Salafi jihadism. Let me talk about ideology for a second. All too often when people mention ideology, people think it means some great thinker thinking deep thoughts about Islam and violence and jihadism. And, you know, ideologies, whether they are religious ideology or ideologies connected to religion or political ideologies, cover a multitude of sins. And they include scholars and morons. They include criminals and adventurers. We often think, when we think of ideology, we think of this high, rarefied field of ideology instead of what sometimes is a bumper sticker view of an ideology, a boiled down, simplistic, dumbified, made simple form of an ideological worldview. The challenge for us today is whether we can be fierce, cunning, and deadly enough to defeat this threat without losing our way and our souls in the process. ISIS today as the state, as the physical state, is weaker. But ISIS, the idea, is still lively and potent. In the field that I focus on, which is especially social media, I'd like to make some points about where we are right now and where we're going. Number one, the footprint of ISIS and its supporters on social media today is smaller, both in terms of volume and in the time the material stays on. We at Memri, for example, used to have the luxury of seeing something and we would go back and look at it and, you know, oh, what did that video say? Now, actually, we don't have that luxury. If you go back, it's gone. Even on platforms that traditionally were promiscuous or permissive, permissive is better than promiscuous, permissive in the use of, in ISIS being on there. Things like archives.org or just paste it. Today, that material disappears much more rapidly than it used to a year ago or even, or 2 years ago. So you see this across the board. The actual production of the Islamic State is down. Some show a decline of one half to two thirds in non-military related ISIS media from Iraq and Syria over the first months of 2016. So there's less stuff being produced. And there's more anti-ISIS material available. One organization which I highlighted in the U.S., what are the initials for it? I have it here somewhere. The International Center for the Study of Violent Extremism. Its sole job is to promote the stories, the narratives of ISIS defectors or ISIS recanters. So there's more material available in the public space. There's also, as some have boasted about it, there's more cyber warfare. There's more dirty tricks. There's more stuff being done to the terrorist material, and also more efforts from social media companies overall to take it down. And obviously, there are more military defeats on the battlefield in Syria and Iraq. So that's to say, if that was the case, you'd say the glass is half full. However, and there's always a however, the ISIS footprint on social media is still very large. It's still massive. It's smaller than what it was before, but it's still extensive. Anyone, as some of you have, I know, who spend any time looking at the ISIS channels on Telegram, and you have that annoying, if you have, like I do on my computer, that ding, ding, ding as things appear, you know, it's like winning a game at roulette or something, a constant dinging as this flood of material on Telegram alone continues to appear. Text, video, pictures, link. It's huge. It's less than it was, and it's huge. And what we've seen, and we continue to see after Nice, after Ansbach, after Normandy, we see the ability of the Islamic State and its supporters to surge or to promote its material at will. And we still see the open kind of shameless presence that they have in social media, including the fact that, for example, one of the killers of the Normandy priest boasted just days ago about wanting to attack a church in French on Telegram. So you can see that despite all the efforts, despite material being taken down, despite all the efforts at making it smaller, which have had some success, they still can basically do what they want, when they want it, and how they want it. One of the reasons for this will be my second point, is the symbiotic relationship they have with the mainstream media. And that includes those of us who work on it. I mean, I'm sure many of us who work in the field do what I do, is we look at the material. We always look to see if there's something interesting, some image, something that we can mine, that we can use in our research and our tweeting or whatever. We are also, in a way, doing the work of the Islamic State in propaganda. They have learned how to become an essential part of the 24-hour news cycle of the media. and spectacular attacks by the Islamic State and these dubiously connected, so allegedly inspired lone wolves generate their own media storms. They generate their own chains of material because the Islamic State is news. It's news and it's in the news business. Finally, in terms of what they're doing, despite the decrease in social media that you see, the Islamic State and its followers are still deeply interested in returning to Twitter. They're still constantly looking for new platforms, new ways to get their message out. They are, if nothing, intensely creative and adventurous in trying to find new ways of getting material out. And we see this from day to day. So, for example, we at Memri, who follow this closely, in the last few days, we've seen a surge in Instagram for some reason. In the last 48 hours, there's been a surge of ISIS material in Spanish, for example. These things, all of us who follow it, you see them. They come and they go. Sometimes they mean something and sometimes they don't. But certainly this is a dynamic space and they seek to return to where they are. So even though they've been largely blunted on Twitter, they still see, and they've said so only a few weeks ago in An-Naba, where they talked about An-Naba Al-Wafa Foundation publication, where ISIS talked about that Twitter actually has special utility that they like, the connectivity of it, the kind of the broad range of it that they like. So what are we to do? Well, certain things. Obviously, this social media pressure that has happened over the last year, 2 years, needs to continue. They need to continue to be blocked. They need to continue to be removed. We need to continue to mow the social media lawn. We need to continue to have this discussion with those platforms that have been recalcitrant or less eager to take ISIS channels and ISIS propaganda off. Telegram, just paste it, archives.org and others. We need to continue to do this. Secondly, military progress is a factor which is really important in the struggle against the Islamic State, but we have a real problem here. We have a problem in the intensely sectarian nature of the conflict going on in the region, and you see this reflected in the propaganda. You see this reflected in how the advances of the Iraqi army and the advances of Kurdish forces in northern Syria are portrayed in social media. Members of the Syrian opposition came up with a new acronym for the YPG, calling them Quwat al-Qasad, you know, the QSD, right, which is the Syrian Democratic Forces, making it sound like Assad, right, to try to give that impression. We've actually seen pro-rebel, not pro-ISIS, pro-rebel social media activists repurposing YPG material, presenting it in a anti-YPG, anti-SDF way to heighten sectarian tensions in northern Syria. So military progress is an essential part of the propaganda war, but is rife with problems. And of course, the biggest one being that the question of what happens after. All of the issues that led to the rise of the Islamic State, all of the dysfunction, all of the pathologies, political pathologies that led rise to the Islamic State, are still fervent, existing, and growing throughout the region from North Africa to the Arabian Peninsula. I worry sometimes that, and I think maybe Nancy's going to talk about this, I worry that we all too often talk about the disasters that have happened, the Syrias and Iraqs of the world, rather than the ones that have not happened, the Saudi Arabias, the Egypts, and the Algerias of the world. The last point I would make is that while there's been some progress, there's been one area where there's been very little progress, and it's because it's the most difficult one. I talked about ideology. I talked about ideology as a profound, deep worldview, and ideology as a bumper sticker for shallow, stupid young people. This is the area where the least amount of progress has been made. What is the alternative to a revolutionary ideology in a revolutionary time, which is what we live with the Islamic State in the region and worldwide? I think this is the big frontier, the big challenge that we have not focused on. Yes, we're making progress on social media. Yes, there's some progress being made on the battlefield. But that world of the mind, of motivations of people and why they do things is the area that we have done the least amount of work And I think it's the most important one to defeat the Islamic State. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alberto. I can't even begin to sort of say your final point, I think, is the point we need to make sure we grasp fully. We know what they do, we know how they do it, but it's what's driving these people to do this stuff. And I think that takes us very well into Shiraz, please.
Thank you very much. So I will talk about ideology, and actually, Alberto, without knowing it, set me up perfectly, because that's exactly the point that I was going to make. When we've seen the attacker, for example, from Nice, or we've seen the shooter in Orlando, or in various other cases, there's been this discussion, well, they weren't sort of orthodox Muslims, they weren't sort of classically what you describe as an observant practicing Muslim, someone who was known for frequenting the mosque, and who was fasting, and doing this and this. These were people who largely led lives that weren't all that religious, or seemingly, apparently, so. So what is the role of ideology, and what is the role of how that sort of is transposed onto some of these events that we've seen taking place in the West? In that context, I think it's very important, as Alberto said, actually, this, when we think about ideologues, or we think about the way ideology works, we tend to think of people who've done these sort of lofty studies of key texts and books and had sort of theorized through a number of things and arrived at a very considered conclusion before deciding to act. That's not how, in general, ideologies work. Yes, there are people who drive the movements, who do these things, but these provide essentially the superstructures then through which individual agents are able to give meaning and value to their otherwise actions that would be meaningless. And so it allows you to give and invest a particular act with purpose and with agency where otherwise would not have the ability to do so. That's where a group like Islamic State today operates so successfully and so vehemently. And part of its reason for doing that and the ability it has to project in a much more dramatic fashion than even Al-Qaeda was able to do is because it has two things behind it. One is this sense of momentum, and the second is linked to that is this sense of statehood. And because it has these things, and it seems to have, at least to its followers or sympathizers, given this statement of the Khilaf and having a Khalif in place, then if you are someone who believes in that idea, the institution in and of itself is a very powerful, motivating and mobilizing factor, which gives people, as I say, cause and agency, and has sparked a number of these attacks in a way that Al-Qaeda wasn't able to do, because it operated in a fashion that was much more theoretical. So it was sort of saying to you, look, there's a war going on, it's the West versus Islam, Haqq and Batil, and this kind of thing. But the images, if you think about it, that it was using to mobilize and to rally people were ones essentially of persecution. Right? Here is the West bombing Muslims, here is the West destroying Muslim lives, infrastructure, that kind of thing. And whilst we see a lot of that in IS propaganda, the vast majority of IS propaganda, I know Charlie Wint will probably speak about this tomorrow in his presentation, the vast majority of IS propaganda is completely different. It's sort of more reminiscent, I tend to think of it as sort of North Korean propaganda, which is trying to show you the physics of everyday life to say, look how normal we are, look how ordinary we are. So a lot of the propaganda looks at, here's a marketplace, here's something we've built, here's a school, here's a fun fair for children. It's sort of showing you the everyday because it wants to say, we are a successful state, we are a progressive state, we're ordinary. That's what makes us so extraordinary, that we've achieved the ordinary where no one said we could. And that's really what's kind of underlying their aim and their ability, as I say, to project. One of the really important, I think, sort of tactical innovations that shouldn't necessarily be fully credited to them, but is sort of sprung up around them at the moment, is that when we thought about terrorism in the post 9/11 environment, and to a degree before that as well, we thought of relatively sophisticated plots involving conspiracies of several people who would acquire bomb-making material and then who would undertake an action. So if you were a young person who was inspired by Al-Qaeda rhetoric, if you were a young person who was supportive of their aims and objectives, if you saw something like the Madrid bombings or the 7/7 attacks here in London, you couldn't instantly mobilize and take inspiration from that to do something yourself because there were all these various barriers in your mind to participation in that sort of act. What something like Nice has shown, what Orlando has shown, what the attack just the other day in the church in Normandy has shown is that everyday ordinary items that are fairly accessible, guns less so in Europe, but in general, a knife, a vehicle, using these and weaponizing them as sort of terrorist instruments to cause havoc and to kill civilians and to take lives. And you don't need to take that many. Nice does, but going to a church and killing two priests in and of itself is a hugely polarizing event for France and for the world more generally. And so IS has been able to show its followers, or to at least communicate this feeling to its followers, that you don't need a terrible degree of sophistication, you just need the will. And if you have the will, then the rest is all there. And we're seeing, unfortunately now, this uptick, as we have done particularly in France and Germany. And I don't think we've seen the end of it in that regard. I would dare say we're in for the long haul now in terms of how this might play out. Returning then to that notion of ideology and where it's heading, as Alberto was saying, where does it go? We sort of seem to be still in the same place. A lot of my own research looking into this has sort of suggested to me, at least, that conflict seems to be the primary moment of ideational and intellectual development within, in particular, Salafi jihadi thought. And we're seeing that particularly in 2003 in Iraq, and as a response to the Iraq war, a number of theorists began to think through a lot of different issues about how a sort of non-state militarized group of, you know, so-called mujahideen should fight, what the rules of that engagement should be, what the shape and form of a jihadist insurgency or military campaign should look like. What's interesting about that is that in 2003 and during that time, Al-Qaeda produced a lot of books. So as Alberto was saying, you get videos, you get links. Al-Qaeda produced a lot of theoretical material in addition to war footage. And that theoretical material was aimed at the Muslim world to convince them of the validity of what they were doing. So they would spend hundreds of pages trying to posit themselves within a religious tradition. Now, I'm not saying that they did that correctly or whatever. I'm saying that's how they attempted to portray and market themselves. So they say, we are part of a religious tradition. They try to link themselves back to important scholars from Islamic antiquity, such as Ibn Taymiyyah, to say, look, here is a chain of continuity of thinking that we are part of. And so you've got this huge volume of material, which again, for people like me who research this stuff, is very interesting to read and to look at and to examine. And what I've really noticed alongside the Syrian conflict now, which is of course a crucible from which you would expect to see a lot of change, is that IS doesn't produce rafts of theological and ideological material. Again, tomorrow you'll hear from Ayman, who probably brings more ISIS documents to public attention than anyone else. And what's so remarkable about these documents is they're mostly administrative. They're about the functions of statehood, but they're not ideological. They're not theoretical. They're not discussing the nitty-gritty of what should be happening from a theological perspective. It's operationalized documents that you see from them. On the flip side, and this is the great sort of untold story, really, although it's been told more now, of the Syrian conflict, is that Al-Qaeda is still very much around. It's still very much a part of this conflict, and they are the ones who are innovating today still. They are the ones who are thinking very interestingly about theology in this conflict, and they're the ones introducing innovations. And what you're seeing, particularly around the Idlib province where Al-Qaeda is operating, is a greater pragmatism in its approach. You're seeing a greater sort of understanding of how to maybe moderate some of the hard edges of Islamic theology in order to win public opinion. I really believe that it's this desire to win public opinion that is driving this, rather than any sort of change of heart, per se, from the group. But they're realizing, to carry public opinion, to bring people with you, you need to sand down some of the edges. And so you've seen an interesting discussion within Al-Qaeda and some of its literature about suspending the hadood, for example, which are the divinely mandated punishments that are talked about in Islamic scriptures. So they've suspended those in most areas that they're running. I'm not going to say they've never implemented it at any stage, but the idea that they're suspending it and that they're justifying it, not through political expediency, but with reference to religious doctrine and trying to find a way to do that, speaks volumes of the way in which they're attempting to carry public opinion, are socializing Syrians in the areas that they control to their program, and therefore they operate in a slightly different way to IS, which is, of course, IS rules very coercively over the civilian populations that it governs over. Jabhat al-Nusra has a greater degree of public support. Again, I'm not suggesting that Syrians love Jabhat al-Nusra, but certainly in the areas they control, there is a greater degree of socialization and support for the cause of Jabhat al-Nusra and what it is implementing. And I'll just end with this, which is that we've seen over the last few days, again, if you follow this closely, you'll have seen that Jabhat al-Nusra, it's sort of in theory, we've been speculating a lot about whether they will break with Al-Qaeda formally or not. And I think if they do or not, that may produce, again, another phase of ideological and theological change. We don't know yet what's going to happen. But even just whilst we've been in this room in the last hour or so, Jabhat al-Nusra again announced, we'll be doing it shortly, and have published the picture of their leader, Jolani. So I think there's something in the fact that he's coming out brazenly, just like Baghdadi did. He stood on the steps of the Mosul, on the pulpit of the Mosul Grand Mosque to declare his caliphate. He came out very brazenly. That was an important political moment for ISIS to do that. And so for Jabhat al-Nusra to be, as it were, unveiling their leader now and having sort of teasing that this statement will be coming, I think there's something important and significant that will follow. But it's not yet clear. So that would be my take-home message. The important group, really, from the broader ideas aspect of this conflict is going to be Al-Qaeda. It's going to endure and persist in perhaps a more important way than IS, although IS, of course, is the immediate threat versus the longer-term threat of Al-Qaeda.
Thank you very much. Lots in there that we can certainly come back to. Nancy, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me here, and it's great to be sharing the panel with Alberto and Shiraz. It's also very hard to... So basically, the kind of work that we do is based on trend analysis. We follow the trends of terror attacks, primarily in Egypt, but also, I mean, all over the world. And we also do some analytical work based on for the support of policymakers and to give recommendations for policymakers. The kind of subject that I'm going to talk about today and focus on is based on the field work that I did interviewing ex-ISIS fighters. Findings that I have is based on meetings and interviews that I had with ex-ISIS fighters, some of the rebels. I conducted these interviews on the borders of Aleppo, plus some interviews with policymakers who are working on the anti-ISIS coalition. And I think, I'm going to frame my talk around two points, is answering the question, are we winning the war against ISIS, and what are the parameters for that? And the second point is that, who are the people who join ISIS and why do they join them? And try to frame the conversation around that. So for the first point is like, are we losing the war against ISIS? The five dimensions that are listed under the anti-ISIS coalition is just first the military dimension. The second is cutting the finances to the terror groups, and third, cutting the access of foreign fighters going to ISIS and joining them, and the fourth is stabilization and reconstruction, finding a space that is safe for people to live in. They don't have to go to live under the terror groups' controlled areas, and finally is counter messaging. Now, Over the past months, there were a lot of people sort of celebrating or recognizing triumph that ISIS is losing territory and seeing this as a sign that they are failing. This view is problematic for two particular reasons. When we recognize the failure of ISIS by the diminishing land that they have over, we are actually falling into their own narrative and recognizing ISIS as a state, because this is the definition of nation state by the rules and the dimensions of international relations. By definition, it is a territory considered as an organized political community under a government. So when we define that ISIS is losing because they are losing land and territory, we are actually legitimizing ISIS as a state. It's just another country around the world, but only not a member of the UN. The other problem with the not recognizing that is that we're not seeing what the function or why are we fighting ISIS in the first place. The success of ISIS, or what they brag about, or why we fight them, is their ability to cause harm. So it's not directly related to the amount of land that they have. It's about their ability to inflict harm or cause harm. So this brings to the question, are they capable still to cause more harm? I think at least looking at Europe over the past week, I mean, from July 18th until July 26th, there were six attacks, and they were like happening frequently all over the world. And it's becoming, I mean, they're being, I mean, as Shiraz mentioned, it's the tools and the ability for them to use, I mean, to in order to have the attacks, and it's not just, no longer just an issue of bombing. I mean, you can drive a truck into an area filled with people, or you go with a knife, so the tools are not a problem. So this is, I mean, an issue. I mean, if we look at also, I mean, this is in Europe, but if we look also at the groups who are operating or the different wilayat, taking Egypt as an example, I mean, because Alberto mentioned it. So taking the example of Egypt, and again, that reflects on the idea that the issue is not the land or the territory that they occupy. In 2015, in northern Sinai, there were 430 attacks. In 2016, in the first 6 months alone, there were 374 attacks. So that for them is an increase in their ability to inflict attacks and inflict harm. In the last 2 months alone in northern Sinai, there were 116 attacks. So we're seeing from this that despite the military campaign, despite the loss of the land, they are still able to do. Actually, I mean, the ability to for them not to be focused in the land is igniting this whole process of people around the world, I mean, like youth joining them and conducting attacks on their behalf. Now, when we think about the question of like who actually join ISIS or claim, I mean, they are part of ISIS, and why do they do it? Is it for the religious reasons? Is it for other reasons? I think one of the first misconceptions, and again, I mean, like this follows and relates to the territory issue. When people talk about the Islamic State, they usually try to attack it on normative basis. So this is not the right version of Islam, this is not true Islam, or this is not Islam at all. I mean, but if you think about it in terms of taking the analogy of youth who are doing drugs, I mean, youth who are doing drugs don't go have, I mean, like, use drugs because they think it's good or they're under an illusion that it is good, but it serves a function for them. And that's an important distinction, that seeing and framing the issue of ISIS just because it's bad and that's going to resolve the problem in the campaign against ISIS is not really going to be functional, it's not going to be effective. Because when you look at the different and variety of people who join, I mean, join ISIS or do or conduct attacks on their behalf, it really shows that they are so different. I mean, and people go into some futile intellectual exercise, sometimes trying to find what is common between a young Tunisian in a small city and a person who were born and raised in southern France. And I think, I mean, this is exactly the same question when you think about it, is like, okay, what is common between those two people if they're, I mean, a young person who are 18 years old and using drugs in Denmark and another one in Sinai? I mean, the issue is not the ideology, and it's not, the ideology is part of it, but it's not really what is the whole, I mean, joining of ISIS is about. The other misconception is that when analysts and some people look at the different groups who are operating, I mean, in Iraq and Syria and the areas around, they tend to see them as static. So they think about there's ISIS, there's al-Nusra, there's Ahrar al-Sham, there's, I mean, Jaish al-Islam. But actually, in reality, they are not static. I mean, fighters are very mobile, and they change loyalty all the time. I mean, they move from one. I was interviewing, one of the ex-ISIS fighters, and he was just like casually saying, just like, I started by, joining Ahrar al-Sham, and it's like, I didn't feel that they are effective enough. And others were offering even more money, so I left them, I joined another group, and then I finally ended up in ISIS because it was more prestigious. Another one actually explained and highlighted the fact, and this is also, reflected in other accounts, who explained that he knows, he's like a group of friends, a group of tribes, decided to leave in Nusra and join ISIS because of tribal dispute. And these people are using drugs and even drink alcohol and has nothing to do with the religious. So, and that also has an implication when we think about when we go frantically trying to analyze the speech that was given by Julani or the speech that was given by Al-Qaeda or ISIS. These things make a difference on the leadership level, but it doesn't reflect or trickle down to the lower ranks on the militants who join ISIS. And in order to even understand this more, we need to think and look at other illicit organizations who are operating and what is attractive in that. Going back to the example of drug abuse, looking at the drug cartels. First of all, their success is not based on the kind of land that they have. It's their ability to function and be mobile, which is relates to the second dimension of the anti-ISIS coalition, which is talking about, cutting finances. And this is very important. Now, speaking to one of the policymakers who's working on this issue, one of the alarming things that I have heard is that now they are going to start dealing with terrorism as a condition rather than as a disease. And this is very significant, because when you deal with terrorism as a disease, then the objective is to eliminate it. And if you deal with terrorism as a condition, then you're trying to live with it and find ways that it is there, you recognize it's existing, and you're living with it. Now, there are, some signs for optimism. I'm going to end up here, and some signs of concern. The signs of optimism is that the competition between the groups themselves, the terror groups, is actually weakening them because they are fighting over resources, they are trying to claim more support, and they're competing on funding and also competing over the fighters themselves. But the other problem that, on the other hand, the so-called or claimed countries who are fighting ISIS are also in competition. Not all of them. It was like Russia on one side by the others. When you have different countries pouring money and support and resources for different groups, that actually eliminate and cancel each other work and end up having an effect that is more of a spoiler effect. You're just trying to cancel, the effect of others rather than actually ending it or solving the problem. So these are.
Right, so thanks to all three of you. Before we go to the audience, there's a common theme here that I want to pick up, taking off from your point, Nancy, about when we're looking at why individuals join illicit organizations. The analogy with the drug trade is something I may or may not be able to do something with, but individuals typically join because of economic gain or they feel more powerful. But equally, as Shiraz was talking about, we do have a longer ideology based in a religious tradition. That provides a certain worldview. And as Alberto was saying, the ideological aspect and the way it's being pushed is a real problem as well. The question I would have for all three of you, are we in a position to address this? Because we've seen in the modern time what we typically associate with political Islam, either extremist versions, as we see with ISIS, or groups like the Muslim Brotherhood saying we'll participate in elections, but they share a common theme. They're going to impose their version of Islam upon everybody eventually, one way or the other. That seems to attract individuals. That seems to have an attraction for a variety of reasons that we can understand, but it also seems to be the key reason why some of these kids are engaging in violence. I mean, we have to ask a question. Why would anybody be convinced to blow themselves up? It's more than just the economic gain of illicit behavior. It's much more than a religion, because no religion justifies blowing anybody up. What's going on here in terms of this ideological idea that I thank all three of you for raising? And I'm just, if you have any sort of thoughts on how the ideology appears to be a much larger motivator than the practical outcomes.
Well, why does it have to be one or the other? I mean, you have, again, I mean, I think obviously Salafi jihadism is a key component of the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda. But if you look at the history of revolutionary movements, again, you have depth and you have shallowness. You have crooks, you have people who do it for self-interest, you have people who shop and go from organization to organization, you have moderates and extremists within an extreme organization. You have all of those elements. So, I mean, I think, you know, we could all study more, but studying the history of revolutionary movements, studying the history of their world, I don't know how we call it these days, you know, the worldwide communist conspiracy that we all knew in the 20th century, you know, and its variations and multi, it was a movement. This is a movement. ISIS is part of it. It's as Shiraz says, I mean, we worry about ISIS. A big concern that we should have is, what if we get something which is like ISIS, but actually accentuates the most effective elements of ISIS while minimizing those elements of it which have been off-putting, a la a refurbished, rebranded Nusra Front, for example. So it seems to me you have a revolutionary ideology which is powerful enough and amorphous enough that it's a chameleon, so it can be all things to all people of a certain type of person, whether you're a crook or whether you're an idealist.
Well, I think, you know, I would just sort of build on that to say, and it has a very powerful ability to deliver for those people. So if you are the crook rather than the idealist, it offers you redemption. If you're the idealist, it's about the good life. So it has this ability to be kaleidoscopic in nature insofar as it provides different things for different people. It shifts to the nature of what it is that they are looking for or hoping for. But when you peel it all back, really, this is what all ideologies are about. All ideologies are about the pursuit of some sort of utopia and the pursuit of the ideal. And unfortunately, in particular in the Middle East, it's sort of the conditions are ripe for that circumstance. People are looking for something. They have a degree of affluence, a degree of education. They have various things, but they don't have the broader political conditions which allow them to be free citizens. And so you have this ability to offer people this utopia, utopianism. And it's a highly destructive, potent thing, actually. I mean, really, ideology in that sense is a very dangerous notion because it aims to aspire to provide the perfect life, right? It says we can achieve nirvana. This is how you get there. And of course, when it falls short, then the gap between the reality and the expectation means you have to search for, you know, what the problem is. Why is the Khilafah, as ISIS members see it, not thriving? Why is it being the kuffar are attacking us? Oh, and there are these people here. I mean, how often have you seen in ISIS propaganda them executing spies? Right? So if every one of these guys, even a tenth of them, were actual spies, it would be one of the most infiltrated organizations known to man. But it's the paranoia, because we're not achieving what we're supposed to be achieving, but we have this khilafah. So how can it not be? It's your fault. Yeah. You're the problem.
I think, I mean, speaking from a policymaker perspective, I think the problem is that we're trying to solve long-term issues with short-term solutions, and this is problematic again. I mean, the issue of, I mean, fundamentalism, and I mean, like talking to, you're focused on the issue of ideology. I mean, this is not something that you can resolve by having a CVE program in no matter how many millions you're going to pour over it. Particularly, I mean, it takes a lot of, I mean, the generations that are raised, I mean, and learn and fed these issues, I mean, and ideologies. But the second thing also, I mean, it is very important to realize that the span of time for radicalization for a lot of people that we've been observing, it's very short. I mean, it's very hard to actually even capture it and see it as like, I mean, how short it, someone who has been, you would considered normal, I mean, turn into, I mean, someone who is ready and trained and able to go and bomb themselves up. And the second thing, if you look at the attacks that happened in Europe, right, from July 18 to July 26, the average age was between 17 and 21. And there is one of them was actually a minor, a child. These are people who do not like pour themselves over a book and read and just analyze, I mean, the interpretation, and then decide is like, okay, this is the right thing to go after, and I'm going to follow this kind of ideology, and I prefer Nusra over ISIS, and I'm going to go blow myself in allegiance with that. It has more complex and different dimension, and that's why the efforts that to have direct counter messaging to counter the messaging of ISIS is not really the, I mean, it should not be one way or the other. It's not the right or only solution, because I think it's more important to provide more open and peaceful spaces for those youth to engage and feel part of, rather than trying to just try to put off all those, I mean, fires that are igniting because of ISIS.
Great, thanks. Right, I want to open up the floor now. Need to ask a technical issue to make sure we can capture all of this for the post-production videos. Rajan has a mic that he will provide to people, so please speak in the mic, even though it doesn't provide audio for the whole room. I kindly ask that you introduce who you are and where you're from. So one gentleman in the front and the person in front of them.
I was with a friend on a Sunday last year, and we visited the mosque in Regent's Park. We were served with some milk and sweet meats, and then we were invited in to take part or to listen to their service, or whatever you call it. So we were given two chairs, and we sat down quietly, and we waited till the, whatever he's called, the muezzin to come in, and for the worshippers to slowly filter in. While we were waiting, a young Pakistani lad from wherever came down and crouched by my side and looked up, and for the next few minutes walked on about God this, God that, and God whatever the wording was. Now, I looked at him, and he was obviously conditioned to saying what he did. I would have liked to have told him. Ever thought of sport? If you're from Pakistan, good cricketers over there, which is much better than what you've been taught. And have you ever thought of playing football or any other sport? That's what I would have liked to have said. And good parentage to show how these chaps can play together sport against other groups, shall we say, other countries, I think would be the beginnings of the answer to the problem you're discussing at the moment.
Right, so the main point of the question was about social activities, the family, community-based activities, the sport. I'll ask for a quick response, just because going back to our event last year on jihadist insurgency, one of our experts from Belgium gave us an anecdotal element where an entire Sunday League football team was radicalized and ended up going to Syria. So I know it's one of those situations, but is there more we can do in community-based activities about community, about family, that can help address the problems you guys have sort of addressed?
Can I just say, I don't even think that was the question. I don't think necessarily there was a question in it, but religious upbringing and even religious conservatism per se shouldn't be a problem, and we shouldn't regard religious conservatism or religious practice, even amongst youth, as a de facto or necessarily bad thing, which is certainly what I was taking away from some of your comments. If a young person wants to lead and live a religious life, good for them. The problem is when individuals stray into extremism. Conservatism should not be conflated with that necessarily. So even within a practice of Islam such as Salafism, it's a very broad tradition of which most adherents are quietists. They don't care about the world. They're concerned about how long their beard should be. Leave them to it. It doesn't bother you, it doesn't bother me. So I think part of the public discourse around this, we have to be very careful. People have the right to lead religious lives if they choose, and to play football and cricket and all the rest of it. I mean, Moin Ali is a great example of someone who is quite a conservative Muslim and is a well-performing cricketer for the English cricket team.
Yeah, I mean, there's one thing we sometimes don't like to hear. We like to kind of put things in neat boxes, but there is a different, there's a difference, and I think it's an essential difference between someone thinking that you're going to hell and someone trying to send you to hell. and we need to recognize that those are two different things.
Just to say, I mean, the issue is not just sports. I think offering a space for not secular, but at least peaceful oppositions or peaceful activists around the world. I mean, right now, you have two situations where you have the terror groups are proliferating their propaganda and just injecting their messages. And on the other hand, you have the authoritarian regimes who are using this as a way to crack down on any form of opposition. And that creates a space, actually a shrinking space, for those people to voice their demands, have a space to act, and you leave them no other alternative except, I mean, joining those. So it's not just sports, but generally, I mean, a more, I mean, peaceful space for others to operate.
What sense do you think the sense of isolation, the lack of social mobility? I mean, it's interesting that these attacks have occurred in France and Germany, where the immigrant communities are not integrated and where they don't have the opportunities. I've been traveling to France for a number of years and to Paris, and I've always noticed when I've gone to Paris that how separate the community, the French Algerians, the French Moroccans are from the host community. I mean, I think this is an opportunity for the governments in the region, French and Germans, to look at their integration policies, compare it to what's happening here in the UK, where it's much more successful, and there's a lot more upward social mobility. I think there's a sense of desperation and isolation, and just lack of opportunity for young people, and this is shown in the attacks in Germany. I think that there's a sense of not belonging, where these governments really need to search and say, how are we going to open up our communities and give access to jobs, education, and the future?
So my name is Fisher Bronfman, and I'm from the Dutch Embassy. My question is, would the size of the actual caliphate decreasing, will the virtual caliphate become a bigger threat than the actual caliphate? Thank you.
Okay, so we'll community isolation and the issue of the virtual caliphate, please.
Yeah. Well, concerning the community isolation, I mean, it's spot on. I mean, it is a huge issue, particularly with the refugees who actually live in European countries. I've noticed this in visiting, I mean, some of the refugee camps, I mean, again, on the borders of Syria and Turkey. I mean, and the people who are talking about the issues that's frustrating, I mean, I was talking to one of the psychologists there, and my first concern is asking, are you worried about, I mean, radicalization, where these young people are in one group, I mean, living in just confined space? And she actually says, like, this is the least of our worries. Our biggest problem is that you're having a community living in a confined space. The man is not working, the woman is frustrated with the kids. The kind of stress, domestic violence that is inside leads to more aggression even within the community itself. Add to that in terms of even the language, I mean, like, a lot of people don't even speak Turkish there, and it increases the sense of isolation. It's the same thing in Europe. I mean, there are really good and admirable steps for a lot of people who are actually just giving language classes and tutoring for the refugees to try to integrate them. But is this enough to integrate them into society? That's not really, I mean, something that can be resolved overnight, but I'm just saying it is indeed one of the most important factors. As the very other important question is about the virtual ISIS or the virtual state, is it more dangerous than the actual ISIS state? I think definitely yes, and no one should undermine the symbolic power of the existence of something, an entity called the Islamic State online and over there. And even though they might not provide actual resources or finance or weaponry, the idea that there is something bigger, that some of the other groups who form themselves as wilayat and pledge allegiances to ISIS extend this symbolic power and symbolic capital from the existing of this something that is bigger. So it is definitely...
Well, on the first issue, I'm not an expert on kind of European societies and integration, but I would note in my travels in Western Europe and the continent, talking to Muslims and activists, I have one thing that they've told me is that, you know, something which is obvious, maybe it's different in the UK, but not all Muslims are the same, and not all Muslim communities are the same. And there are countries in continental Europe, for example, where you have large communities of, say, Turkish Muslims, where you have a much lower level of radicalization than you do, for example, among North Africans in some countries in Western Europe. So not all groups are the same. On the virtual caliphate, you know, this is a really good question. There's never been a virtual caliphate before. So we're all basically kind of guessing. I mean, hopefully educated guesses. It seems to me that there has to be at some point a tipping point, and this is, I think, what the coalition is hoping for, that at some point the gap between the physical state, collapsing physical state supposedly, and the virtual state will be so big that it can no longer be papered over by attacks in Europe, the efforts of the wilayat, all this other stuff, that at some point the gap will be too obvious and too deep to be covered by propaganda and by kind of blue smoke and mirrors. Nobody knows for sure. That's something that we're going to actually see whether that's the case. I would say that generally one intelligence officer in the Middle East told me, and he was a Sunni Arab Muslim intelligence officer. I hope he knew what he was talking about. He said, there is no tradition of kind of losing by winning amongst us. That the idea of kind of a Pyrrhic victory is something that in the long term doesn't really work. You notice what ISIS always says, we're going to conquer Rome bi-ithnillah, right? By permission of God. Well, if you keep losing, and really losing, at some point you're going to have to say, you don't have idhnallah, you have manallah, you know, Allah has forbidden you from having this. But we haven't reached that point yet, and as Nancy says, we're in this very dangerous situation now where the virtual caliphate is not weak, and so we don't know what that tipping point is going to be, where we've done enough and things change, especially as I said in my remarks, when the winners, or the ones that are winning territory against the Islamic State today, are sectarian actors who come with all kinds of baggage, and who, we have no guarantees that actually they're going to change things, again, another point of the coalition, change things on the ground in a different way to make sure that the situations which led to the rise of the Islamic State in the first place no longer exist.
To say very quickly, on integration, of course, in the long run, that's the key to so much of this, because people don't attack what they feel a part of, right? And so by definition, individuals who are launching attacks in the West don't feel like they're part of it. But it's one strand of a much broader element. And I agree with this perspective, actually, that not all Muslim communities, even in the West, are necessarily the same. And indeed, across the various different countries as well. So if when I speak to French Muslims or German Muslims, they say, look, you know, you've got it really good in Britain. Like, Britain is the best place in Europe probably to be a Muslim as far as they're concerned. I think they're actually right when they make that assessment, because it's much harder in France or in Germany or these places. So Britain has these opportunities. Yet, in the post-9/11 climate, it was this country that had a major problem with terrorism. And it was the French saying, your integration model hasn't really worked. We've worked it out and you haven't. And now what are people saying? Saying, you know, the French have kind of messed this up. Britain's got it really worked out. I mean, it goes to show that these things don't really mean that much. But integration as a whole, not just as a counterterrorism tool, is clearly very important, and it's a long-standing aim. This idea, just in the response to the lady's question about the caliphate being under pressure, you know, we hear a lot about this, the caliphate's under pressure. I don't think that's right at all. It's losing territory here and there. Mosul and Raqqa are what you have to think about if this thing is going to collapse. And I see no pressure on either of those. And the pressure on them has to be simultaneous. You can't take Mosul and just expect Raqqa will fall, or vice versa. And the fact that these two cities are sitting in sort of nominally two separately sovereign states is in essence underscoring the difficulty. We've seen how difficult it is to take out an insurgency when it operates across a border in the AFPAC region. If you can't do it there, the idea that this thing is going to collapse anytime soon, I think, is a misnomer. When I talk to everybody about this, I say, think of this whole crisis as something that will go on for decades. It'll probably take the rest of our lifetimes. Syria and Iraq will burn. I just don't see a short-term solution to this. But if you do, let's say, sack Mosul and Raqqa, you kill Baghdadi and so on, Islamic history has precedent for this. Under the Abbasid Caliphate, the Khalif was killed under a wartime scenario, and they went 3 years without reviving that institution. So the resonance of the idea will still remain. And actually, because they're the first ones to have really come out and said, we have established a Khilafah, not an emirate or the Khilafah, that really has such a strong resonance that even if you take this out, yes, there'll be a huge loss of momentum for them. But for the real hardened ideologues and people who are really committed, by definition, that just because the Khalif has been killed, it doesn't end the project. So there will be this strong resonance, and certainly a virtual presence in that sense is going to keep alive the idea longer than the physical realm might be able to.
I'm Danielle of DeSantos. I'm currently a Sciences Po undergraduate student. I'm currently writing my senior thesis on possible links between French political culture and radicalization in France. And so my question concerns the use of the term radicalization when we're trying to understand the profiles of all those fighters that are joining ISIS. As you said, there's many different types of fighters, and each of them has their own motivations. For them, ISIS like fulfills a specific function, but when we look at the use of the term radicalization, I've talked to different researchers that some of them don't necessarily agree with the use of the term radicalization to describe such different processes of like what leads to them joining the Islamic State and the organization of the Islamic State. And so what would be your take on using the term radicalization as one term to describe such different processes?
My name is Madeline McSherry, and I'm pursuing a master's in international relations over at the LSE. There's a lot of talk about ideology, ISIS ideology, as a motivating factor, but I guess what I want to ask, or I guess challenge a little bit, is that to what extent can we see the ideology not so much as a motivating factor, but simply as a resource that's available, as something that's out there and available to a disillusioned or as a population with grievances? Because I think if we think about it that way, or at least in part that way, it would change the way we approach the problem. So while blocking Twitter is really important, just kind of blocking the ideology is not necessarily going to fix those underlying issues.
Reem Mumtaz, I'm with ABC News. I want to talk about the pledges of allegiance and the claims of responsibilities with these attacks. How do we put these in the proper context or calibrate the way we link them to ISIS when we see that with the Nice attack, we haven't seen a pledge of allegiance from the attacker, and the five accomplices that are still in custody right now have still not been linked to any kind of jihadist movement by the French authorities. That's on the one hand, although Amak put out a claim of responsibility by ISIS, right? And then yesterday, the attackers on the church, they did put out a Pledge of Allegiance kind of video, but then you saw that the ISIS flag that they use actually has inverted colors. So it's just, it seems to be many different levels of ISIS involvement or not involvement.
All right, Shiraz, we'll start with you on all these.
All right. So in relation to the first question about the use of the term radicalization and so on, I mean, it's a broad term, clearly, and it covers a multiplicity of things. And I don't think that's necessarily problematic, per se, insofar as it describes a process. But if we use the very specific example of, let's say, we're looking at the community of people who've gone to fight in Syria and Iraq, then clearly within that grouping, you could boil it down into a number of different typologies, right? So people who are going for a sense of redemption, people who are going for religious seeking, people who are going for issues of masculinity in a lot of cases, and bravado and this kind of thing. So, yeah, within that subsection, you could say, look, that's where I think this element of nuance and understanding comes. Radicalization is a broad term. It's like terrorism. How do you define terrorism? it's a term that exists in our lexicon. It needs to be there to, I suppose, catch a multiplicity of sins. But within it, there are gradations and nuances and so on. So I think that's the important aspect to understand here. And certainly, in the work that we've been doing at ICSR in terms of looking at the foreign fighter communities, then we've gone a long way towards creating a type of a typology in order to categorize the different ways and primary motivations that have for people who have gone. I think that comes back to this ideology as a resource point, that yes, ideology is there. I don't think it's necessarily, and I don't think anyone was saying it's the primary driving factor or the principal motivationary factor. I don't necessarily think it is necessarily that even in a lot of cases or the majority of cases, but it does exist there clearly. And it's very useful in that sense in order to have an ability to give people's, like I said, ideology operates in the way that it gives actions meaning and invests them with purpose. So, you know, people get stabbed all the time and killed all the time. So if you went down Oxford Street and mugged somebody, it's a mugging, it's a criminal. If you do it shouting Allahu Akbar and pledge allegiance to Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, it becomes a materially different act in the way the public and the state will perceive it. So that's the important aspect there of how this operates. And it does turn people, some of the profiles we've seen of these guys, you know, like they say, oh, he was just a loser, or whatever, you know. Yeah, he was a loser who could have been a mugger, but now he's a mujahid. And that's, for him, the important, I suppose, aspect. And that brings me, so neatly, the three questions linked well here to the lady behind you, and that we did see this, like with Munich, you know, he does seem to have been a sort of outlier and so on. I think you're right with Nice. We haven't seen what the connection is, but what's interesting is we have seen with the Axe attack and with the attack 2 days ago now in the church and so on, these guys had sent videos which IS released. I'm just going to say this because I'm sure someone will shout out to correct me, but I don't think IS really claims things it hasn't done. So it didn't try to claim Munich, it didn't try and say this is our guy. When Egypt Air crashed and everyone said, oh, it might be terrorism, there was nothing from IS saying, look, we did that. So I feel like the attacks they've claimed are really the ones that have been theirs, because they don't seem to have opportunistically claimed various things. And certainly when we look at Turkey, they don't claim any of their attacks there. They actually let them go. They don't want to publicly come out and say
they claim a security operation.
I knew someone would shout out.
And also, I mean, on Turkey as well, they did claim something opportunistically involving an American officer.
Okay, the ones in the West generally have not been claimed. I suppose they don't need that level of connection. As I said, I could independently decide now to do something, but put it in the name of ISIS and give it to, you know, allegiance to Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi and all that. And they would accept that. That'd be good enough for them. And really, it's good enough for me. Right, because I want to go out and do this act in their name, then that's the way it operates. So I don't think we need to necessarily get too concerned about it. And the flip side to that, and the danger of that is, if you look at the public debate, and the public feels, particularly some elements, that there is a conspiracy going on, right, and that they are not being misled, and so when there's an attempt, I think something's just, you know, manage some of this down. I'm not saying we should eject nuance from the debate, but I think we also need to call it like it is, because I don't think the French, like Le Monde, is doing the right thing by not talking about the naming the attackers. It builds this notion of conspiracy in people's minds, and that fuels social tension, which is kind of what the terrorists are trying to do. So let's not do that.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, you know, the Islamic State always or often, most of the time, is eager to claim credit for things that it can plausibly claim credit for. It's not looking to make false or completely false claims of credit. I mean, you saw one example very recently. They claimed to have shot down an American plane in Iraq, which the Americans immediately denied. And what did they do? They produced some material of what looked like maybe it was a helicopter. So they hit something. It wasn't exactly what they said, but there was some connection to reality. You know, when we talk about ideology, we sometimes forget, you know, ideology can also be a label. And some of this that we see, some of this mobilization, you can use that word instead of radicalization if you want, is putting a label on something. It allows you to go from the personal and the local to the global and ideological. Instead of some seedy, seamy thing where you killed somebody because you don't like your neighbor or you're anti-Semitic or whatever your motivation is, it becomes part of something big. So I think sometimes we put ourselves in the straitjacket of wanting these very clear boxes. Now, there are clear boxes. There is the preferred way of doing things, which is, you know, the public claim of allegiance and kind of physical evidence of that. But you're not always going to get that. I recall there's, not to compare ISIS and the Nazis, but here I go. Ian Kershaw, in his history of Adolf Hitler, talks about how there was something called National Socialism, but actually in Nazi Germany, and maybe I'm misquoting him, I don't think I am, it was not always clear what the Führer wanted to do. You know, it was unclear. And what local people did, and policemen and officials, they had this phrase which was called working towards the Führer. And there's a kind of a general idea, and you kind of work towards it. You find your own way of kind of expressing your loyalty and expressing your activism. And there's something of that to the way the Islamic State works. There's this broad brush label. Yes, it's a specific ideology, it's a specific state with specific things, but it's also a movement. And think about it, when we talk about ISIS activity online, we have ISIS activity, and then we have the fanboy supporters activity, which is a much fuzzier, weird thing that comes and goes. So yes, there's a specific way of doing things, but there's a much broader brush, a kind of universe or milieu or environment where that ISIS thing exists.
Just very briefly, I mean, talking about, yes, radicalization happened for very different reasons. We said it over, I mean, the past hour. But we also need to differentiate by those who physically go and join ISIS, I mean, from the Middle East, and foreigners who go and join. And they are for different reasons. The ones in the Middle East, because they have, I mean, lots of opportunity and they move between it. Again, it goes back to the idea of functionality. For example, I mean, more and more people are joining Nusra or supporting Nusra because they proved to be very effective in the negotiation. They were able to give access to basic needs, food and medicine, and they were also very clever and effective in releasing and negotiating to release prisoners. So for them, joining them, it's because they are functional. It's not just for the glory of it. When you look at foreigners, and we didn't mention, we've been talking about fighters and the implicit understanding here, where we're always talking about men. But when you think about foreign women, Western women, who go and join ISIS, and from our analysis of the Twitter feeds of them and what they do and what they say, there's an assumption generally that ISIS is like oppressing women and using them. Actually, the ones who go and join ISIS are seen as extremely functional, important, and the role is glorified. And surprisingly, it's like even the women are boosting about, it's like, oh, my love and my husband is going to bomb himself up, or he did that, and we're going to meet in paradise, and I supported him. And actually, in one of the video, the 14 propaganda video calling for the moving to jihad in Sinai, one of the jihadists who are calling for bombing himself, he was proudly saying, like, I decided that I'm going to commit, a suicide attack, and I'm blessed because my wife supported me in this. And so this is, showing that these women go there not to because they love to be oppressed, they actually have a function and a position and a glorified position in that state. So again, it's the functionality, it's the space, it's the connection, and it's so different between when you're talking about Western fighters and the Middle Eastern ones.
Thank you very much. My name is Jonathan Worthington. I'm a Royal Navy officer. I also like to think of myself as a person of faith who enjoys playing cricket. Talk of ideology gets us so far, I think, but I cannot help thinking, I claim no expertise in this area, but I cannot help but think or fear that we might have passed a watershed moment in Normandy. Because up until now, I think the nature of the attacks we've seen have been attacks by something that purports to be a faith, such as the emotions, the heart, against a philosophy or a way of life. But in Normandy, we saw something. It was faith, or something that claims to be a faith, attacking faith, and something that I fear might be much more visceral. And I'm worried about where this might take us, or whether we're likely to see more of this sort of thing. So I very much welcome your thoughts.
I'm a Roman Catholic, and I was, you can't tell, I can tell you I was so shocked by it. Not just because of the killing, how the killing was done, where the killing was done, when the killing was done. But I'm also a person who spent most of their life in the Muslim world. And I could give you a dozen reasons why what these ISIS guys did doesn't represent Islam or doesn't represent even Salafi jihadism. And actually, interestingly enough, there's been criticism online by ISIS supporters of the Normandy attack, kind of questioning the legal, you know, justification for that specific action. But that's not to excuse the intentional, provocative and sacrilegious nature of it. That's, of course, it was intended to do that. In fact, I was surprised that a church had not been attacked that way before. And indeed, there was an effort in France in April of 2015, where it looks like there was a plot to attack a church there. So, you know, it's we live in revolutionary times, and all symbols, those things that we hold most near, are going to be, you know, assaulted and attacked and part of the fray. As I said in my remarks, the challenge is going to be, how are we fierce, how are we clever, how are we ruthless in defeating our enemies, without losing ourselves, right? Without losing our way, without losing our own souls and our own way of life. That's a challenge for all democratic states confronted with terrorism.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to highlight that this is not the first time that it's faith against faith. I mean, even within the sectarianism is basically all about that. I mean, it's just like Sunnis, I mean, attacking Shiites and the other way around. And we've seen, I mean, the bombing of Medina, I mean, like, just very close to, I mean, the Prophet's grave. So this is not really about, I mean, who the enemy is. And I think it's more about how it serves the strategic interest or goals of the organization. And just back to Reem's question at the beginning is, like, how do we know if this is, I mean, really connected or they're trained? I think, I mean, just like looking at the trend of ISIS, I mean, they did change their, I mean, acceptance of certain attacks or the allegiance of some people to their attacks. Because, I mean, if we go back a little bit, we know that the main difference or the main reason for the initial split between AQI and ISIS and the formation of ISIS is that they had exactly the opposite strategic goal. I mean, AQI is like, we're going to defeat the West and then form the caliphate, whereas the other hand, ISIS said, it's like, we're going to build the caliphate and then defeat the West. Now, because of the pressure that they are sort of not extremely, I mean, functional or effective right now, they resorted to have to go out in the West. So, I mean, like, in the first year, they were not claiming that they're going to do any attacks outside of the Middle East or on foreign lands. Now they are resorting to it because they need to show that even though they are being attacked in their own land or the land they have claimed on, they have the ability to inflict harm outside of that as well, and that gives them the show that we are the winning team, which attracts the younger youth. I mean, just like they want to affiliate themselves to something like that.
Just to pick up, I suppose, where Alberto was saying, I mean, there is some theological, you know, discussion around this. Again, online you see, even from important so clerics, I think, will come out eventually and condemn this, even from the Salafi jihadi milieu, as we've seen in the past as well. So as you were speaking, so I wrote down, you know, the Jordanian pilot Muad al-Kassasbeh, again, when they burnt him alive, provoked a huge discussion among Salafi jihadis about the validity of that act, the bombing in Medina, again, very interesting. I mean, this is kind of ISIS's approach, in a sense, which is to, it'll find justification what it's doing, and it will probably construct it on the basis of some very esoteric theology and sort of sophistic reason that they'll put together, but they'll find a way to vindicate themselves. But it's clearly provoked even amongst very radicalized or very militant aspects of, I suppose, Muslims, who are still kind of really taken aback by that. The broader political point, I think, is very important. As you say, it is a watershed moment. I think it will change things. I've been to France a lot since the Charlie Hebdo attacks, and you know, it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse. And one of the things that French counterparts had said to me, actually, was an attack on a church will really change things here. And it was the kind of thing they'd feared. Catholicism, despite the sort of secular state that you have in France, is a really ingrained and very important part of the public consciousness of France, even amongst people who are not particularly religious or who don't necessarily identify as Catholic. It's an important thing there. So just as much as the attack on Bastille Day, in some respects a lesser way, that was an assault on the French identity. The attack in a church in Normandy is a very, very provocative and important moment for them in that sense. This is all part of a broader strategy. Again, I don't think these guys necessarily thought it through in this way, but IS in general has this idea of attacking and doing things to break down what it calls the grey zone. It wants to break down hybrid identity. It wants to break down nuance. It wants to polarize people into what I was saying before, this idea of haq and batil, truth and falsehood, us and them, Dar al-Islam, Dar al-Kufr, right? The Muslims and the non-Muslims. And so the idea that you could be, you know, a French Muslim or a British Muslim or something that's hyphenated is an anathema to them. You have to pull and polarize people. So these attacks do two things. They do precisely that. They tell non-Muslims, look, Muslims can't mix with the West, and Islam has no place in the West. So it pulls back and gives people this sense of fear and this sense of misunderstanding or apprehension, I suppose is a better term, in terms of how they're viewing Muslims. And that's a natural byproduct of this sorts of activity. And then, of course, what it does to Muslims is when that reaction comes, it makes them feel more persecuted and it makes them recoil. So this is devastatingly effective. And you see the political outcome of that. I'm not going to blame all of these various events just on ISIS, but to the extent that you see an unraveling of global order, you see a world in turmoil, you are seeing the return of populist politicians who promote simplistic but strong men arguments, not least Donald Trump, but you see it across Europe as well, leaders who are rising in the continent who are saying, we need to stop this, and we're going to stop it in these ways. And so they are coming to power, or they're not yet coming to power, but they are gaining a momentum and traction. So I think it is a perilous moment for us all, and this attack is very important in that context.
Okay, great. But we do have to draw this first session to an end. Thank you, everybody, for the questions. And I just wish to thank all three of our speakers to get us off to a very good start.
Thank you.